phonetically understood.
Stories in Berlin, Season 3. Hello everyone and welcome to Stories in Berlin Season 3. I am Christina and in this season I read for you chapter by chapter, one chapter per episode, my novel The Berliners, a collection of semi-fictional stories about the life of Berliners during the corona pandemic. All stories take place on the same night in late November 2020 in a lockdown Berlin. Every chapter tells the story of a different Berliner. You shall find Season 3 on iTunes, Google Play, SoundCloud, YouTube and Podbean. If you would like to learn more about this podcast and the Story for Food project with which it is connected, you may visit storiesin.berlin and storyforfood.com. On social media, you may find us at Stories in Berlin and at Story for Food. If you would like to support this podcast and the Story for Food project, please consider a small donation via PayPal at paypal.me/storyforfood. Thank you all for listening. Mara, the decision. Mara had never been particularly fond of making decisions based on her guts. On the contrary, she had always been cautious and irrational. She studied marketing, even if her dream was to become a fashion designer. After her studies, she moved to Berlin from Rome with a secret hope to mingle in the art scene of the city and get involved in some art project or another, eventually self-teaching herself fashion design and creating her own brand. What a wild dream! And even if Berlin was known as the city where wild dreams come true, this hadn't been the case with Mara. Instead, she did a practicum in a big online marketing company where she had remained for 13 years. She was still working there, currently as the head of the Italian sales department, and she loathed her job. However, she couldn't find the courage to quit, even if she had rehearsed in her head the final talk with her boss 1,000 times. In her sentimental life, she was hardly more intuitive and passionate. She dated the first German guy she met in Berlin, and 7 years later, when she was absolutely convinced that he's the dullest man on earth and she was finally ready to let him go, she got pregnant. And her reason crept in again and reminded her that she was 30 years old already, so she'd better stay with the dull guy and have the child. Now little Davide was almost 5 years old. Her then boyfriend, now husband, was always a total bore and her life was dreary. However, just before the coronavirus hit Berlin, something wonderful shook Mara from her tedious existence. A man, a young lover. Jean was 28 and all but boring. He was a freelance journalist and ran a collective dedicated to activism, art and politics. He used hacking, subversive direct actions and civil disobedience to deliver radical messages, as he told Mara when they met, even if she could hardly understand what he meant. In few words, Jean was young, handsome and interesting. He also worked as a clown in children parties and he met Mara in the birthday party of a friend of Davide. He was into older women and a fervent supporter of polyamory. However, after a few encounters with Mara, He asked her if she would leave her husband for him. An hypothetical question, he said. And Mara, who was mad about him by then, and who for the first time in her life felt the thrill of being alive, told him that she definitely would. During the first corona lockdown, Jean and Mara met almost every day as she worked from home while her husband had still to go to his office. During that time, Jean had the chance to bond with little Davide and Mara was beaming with joy. If it was up to her, the lockdown would never end. Then the summer came and Mara would meet Jean secretly in the Hasenheide Park. They were falling for each other more and more, day by day, and for the first time in her life, Mara started to seriously question her rational mind. Jean would contemplate with bewilderment her life choices. For him, it was inexcusable that she had chosen safety over passion, ending up in a job she despised and stuck in a marriage she couldn't stand. Of course, listening to her intuition was something completely new for Mara, but she had to admit that Jean was right. Every night that she had to lie next to her husband, every day that she had to work on online marketing, a little something was dying inside her. And it was somehow like that she had reached November when a new lockdown was imposed to Berlin in an attempt to tackle Corona's second wave. This time, both Mara and her husband were called to work from home. It was impossible for her to find an excuse and go out to meet Jean. She was in great distress, all the more because Jean, who had never abandoned his polyamorous lifestyle altogether, had ceased to reply her messages. Actually, he would write some short message demanding to see her and urging her to talk to her husband. And when Mara, torn between her heart and her family, would explain to him that she was not ready yet to do so, Jean would disappear for days, presumably with another woman. Life was a living hell for Mara, as if all her past choices had mounted up to overwhelm her, to fog her mind, to disturb her sleep. In fact, she was so tormented that she could hardly sleep at night. And to imagine that her husband didn't seem to notice her anguish and he would go by his days as indifferent and negligent as ever. Tonight is the night, she told herself when she came out of little Davide's room after putting him to sleep. She sat next to her husband, who was watching the news on TV, determined to tell him all about Jean and herself. But where to start from? Was she to blame that she had found a lover when anyway she was miserable in her marriage? And whose fault was that her marriage was a total disaster? Certainly hers, for having yelled to reason, never listening to her intuition, which would shout out against her husband every single day. She had trapped herself all on her own. We need to talk, she muttered, and she already felt her voice trailing from fear. After the corona report, her husband replied, detached. Mara stood up, went for a glass of water, and as she opened the tap, she noticed that her hands were trembling. Her breath was short, her heart was racing. She stood there a while, watching the water running from the tap, unable to move. Eventually, her husband came in the kitchen, going over the corona news he had just heard on TV. She couldn't stand it any longer. Her heart was about to break, so violently did it beat with agitation. Listen, she cried out. Listen to me. She could hardly recognize her voice now.
What is it?
He said, and he touched her shoulders and kissed the back of her hair. You are quite tensed. It's frustrating, I know. Have a warm bath. He continued, and he started massaging her shoulders. Mara stood there, unable to react. That was always the case with this man. He would disarm her. He would never give her the space to express herself. What's frustrating? She finally mumbled. And again, the same thought returned to her that her husband, with his dull indifference, his patronizing tone, his fake caring, had took possession of her voice, of her willpower.
The corona situation. I'm pretty sure we won't make it to Italy for Christmas this year. You better tell your parents already.
He said and went back to the living room. Mara followed him.
We need to talk.
She repeated, and her voice was more steady now. There is nothing to talk about. It's not us who make the rules.
The rules? What rules?
Mara sounded almost hysterical. There are almost 1,000 people infected every day in Berlin. The lockdown will last well into the new year. So let's stop arguing about that. There is no Italy this Christmas.
The man cried out annoyed.
We are not arguing about that, Mara said and stood in front of the TV with her hands crossed. She suspected that he wished to turn on the TV again, slipping away the conversation.
Good,
he said and nodded to her to move aside from the TV set.
We still need to talk though, Mara exploded.
About what? He replied loudly. About us. Mara was furious.
Oh, Mara, spare me, he said with a sign of indignation and stood up to go to the bathroom.
Don't run away. You always run away like a coward, Mara continued.
I have enough from this corona depression. You're not the only one affected here. I'm also pissed about it, but I'm not taking it out on you, do I?
What are you talking about? Asked Mara, confused.
Us. I'm talking about us, the man replied.
Mara stared at him, baffled. But before she had the chance to speak, her phone rang. She stood there, stupefied.
Well, pick it up,
said her husband and entered the bathroom. Mara took out her phone and saw that it was Jean who was calling her. She answered almost mechanically.
Hey, stranger.
Jean's voice was warm and husky.
Hey, replied Mara softly and closed her eyes.
She would give everything on that moment to be on his arms.
Any news?
Asked Jean somehow impatiently.
I am on that, said Mara and walked over to the balcony. When can I see you?
Mara didn't reply to that. Instead, she took a deep breath.
I miss you,
Jean exclaimed like a little child.
I miss you too,
replied Mara, and she felt her heart sinking.
There, for the first time, a thought occurred to her.
Jean was a small child. His almost desperate attachment to her little had to do with passion and even less with his polyamory philosophy. He was clinging to her like a little boy to his mother. He absolutely wanted her to leave her husband and move in with him, but he had no accurate plan about how were they to live together. The whole idea was too vague. His request sounded romantic and impossible. And Mara, who for the first time was too close to talking to her husband about her young lover, suddenly had serious second thoughts about the matter.
It was true that her marriage was an unhappy one, that she had made some serious wrong choices in the past, but wasn't she now in the verge of yet another false step? For how was she to move in with Jean when Jean was living in Évêché with three members of his activist collective, all of them engaging in promiscuous sex and doing drugs at least occasionally? And what was she to do with little Davide? She couldn't take him to Jean's and she couldn't leave him behind with her husband. The whole dilemma was absurd. And Mara, who had been too sensible all her life, suddenly was negatively surprised with herself for having taken Jean's request seriously. "Are you there?" Jean asked her over the phone, and at the same time her husband cried behind her back. "What are you doing out there? Get in, you'll catch a cold." Mara stood there stupefied. She stood between the two men of her life and saw all too clear that she was in a mess for being dependent on them to fix her life and make things right for her. She hung up on Jean and came in the living room. Her husband was back on watching TV. She sat next to him and said nothing for a while. Her mind was reeling. What did her husband meant when he said that he was also pissed about them but didn't take it out on her? Could he know anything about her affair with Jean? And why wouldn't he confront her about it? Was he really such a coward? "About our talk," Mara started, but her husband interrupted her. "Who was it?"
"On the phone, just now."
"A friend," muttered Mara. "He must be quite desperate to call you at 11 o'clock in the night," he said. "He is." The words came out of Mara's mouth bluntly. Her husband didn't reply, and Mara was uncertain whether it was out of indifference again or whether his lack of concern was but a strategy to drive her mad. "Do you actually care?" She turned to him. "Care? About your hysterical friends who call you in the middle of the night to tell you about their Tinder adventures? Absolutely not," the man exclaimed with some indignation. "Why? Who do you think it was on the phone just now?" Mara came back to him and felt her anger building up again. "Let me guess. Andrea. Or was it Valentina?" "Andrea is not on Tinder. He's in a relationship for over a year now. And Valentina..." But her husband cut in on her around there saying, "Oh, I don't give a damn. Just let me watch this, would you?" Mara stood up and moved away from him. Tears were burning in her eyes. She closed herself in the bathroom and wept with her hand over her mouth. Her phone rang once more. It was Jean again. She pressed the answer button, but she was unable to utter a word. Instead, she listened to Jean's anxious ramblings. "Mara, amore, I'm going crazy. We can't go on like that. I can't. I really do want to be with you. Be with you and Davide, but not like that. Not like that. Not without seeing you. Not..." Mara came out of the bathroom in a frenzy and went back to her husband, holding the phone on her hands. When she reached him, she put Jean on speakerphone. Her husband looked at her with his usual indifferent expression. Meanwhile, Jean kept babbling on the other side of the line. "It sounds like a dream now, the three of us. Remember what you told me? You said he's the dullest man on earth. It's meant to be, baby, just me and you, traveling south. Remember that?" Somewhere around there, Mara hung up on Jean and said in a low yet determined voice, "Jean, my lover." Her husband
turned back on the TV with a smirk. Mara was furious. She was certain now this man, whom she had been calling her man for 12 years now, the father of her son, was either stupid or wicked.
Jean is my lover. Davide knows him and they get on well together, Mara said in a frenzy.
But her husband didn't let her finish. What's your point? He stormed at her. She stepped back instinctively. Never before had she seen him like that. His eyes were blazing with anger.
I want you out, Mara whispered, and immediately repeated in a more determined voice. I want you out of this house by next week.
So you can bring your lover in? The man lunged at her and grabbed her from the shoulders. This is not happening, he uttered in a menacing voice. Do you listen to me? This is not happening. I'm staying in this house because this is my home, and you are staying here with me because you are my wife. This is our family. Do you understand? He screamed as he shook her shoulders hard. Mara stood benumbed. Her mind was racing, and suddenly it became crystal clear to her that the 12 years she had passed with this man had inured her to fear and agony. He had been passive-aggressive with her since the very beginning, and his apparent calm indifference was but another way to intimidate and control her. She had abandoned her aspiration to study fashion design. She had remained in a job she loathed. She had agreed to their marrying out of concealed fear for this man, a fear so deep that had been almost unperceived to her till that moment. If only she had listened to her heart instead of her mind back then when they met, she would have never been with him in the first place, and she wouldn't be standing, shaking in front of this abuser right now. None of this would have ever happened, she told herself and immediately added, not even Davide.
Mamma, che succede?
Mara heard the little boy's voice behind her. She turned and saw him holding on to her leg. He was sleepy and cold, and his eyes looked terrified. She picked up the boy into her arms and rushed to her bedroom. She locked the door behind her, picked up a small suitcase and quickly threw some clothes into it. Then ran to Davide's room and picked up some of the boy's clothes and his favorite teddy bear. Within 5 minutes, she was standing by the door with the boy always in her arms and a suitcase by her. Her husband was raving at her, but she didn't even raise her eyes to look at him. The little boy burst out crying when his father attempted to grab him. Mara pushed the man away and rushed to the street, holding her son and the suitcase. Automatically, she walked towards the taxi stop. When the taxi driver asked her, "Where to?" a shy smile formed on her lips. "To freedom," she whispered to herself. She didn't have the slightest idea about how her life would be from now on, but she felt an unexpected peace on that moment. Mara had never been particularly fond of making decisions based on her guts. This had probably been her first impulsive decision ever. Yet, for the first time, she had no doubt whatsoever. «Cosa c'è, mamma?» asked Davide, reacting to her sudden laughing. «Ascolta sempre il tuo cuore, tesoro mio», Mara told the boy and kissed softly his head.